Is the book a form of revenge?
No.
Bullshit! Narcissistic bitch. Narcissistic bitch. Narcissistic bitch. Narcissistic bitch. Narcissistic bitch.
Yes. Yeah, sure. You're mute, obviously. Mm? Yes.
The check is all right?
They're still checking now. Oh. They're still checking. Right. If you'd look towards me, this is simply for a cutaway shot. So
right.
If they want to go from question, say, one to question four.
I'm Christina Crawford. Many of you know me from my books, from the original Mommy Dearest to Daughters of the Inquisition. Some of you may know me as a businesswoman or as an actress, which I was for many years. On the outside, I was attractive, if I do say so myself, well-educated, talented, and smart.
The narcissist needs to be the center of attention, and anybody else that's getting any attention is a threat.
Because I am so identified with being the first, the pioneer. But more importantly, I think what has happened is that since I started to tell my story, a lot of people recognized that they found themselves in the same position. And so they came to recognize that they had to do something. And now we're calling ourselves survivors.
They have a really pathological need for admiration. They need people to tell them how smart they are, how interesting they are, how special they are.
Now we're calling ourselves survivors.
Show them how entitled they are. And if that doesn't happen, they get very upset. They get very frustrated, and they can go on the attack.
And when she did Mommy Dearest, it was very, very difficult with her. And after a while, it became hard for me to continue. And that, and I, in the industry, I guess it's called getting burnt out.
Mm-hmm. And you got burnt out.
Yeah,
with
I got burnt out with everything.
And when we say a lack of empathy, these folks just don't have the ability to stand in somebody else's shoes.
Did you ever make it to second base with the kid in camp?
Oh. He was so handsome. He was a lot older than I, and he got expelled from school. But that's life.
Not a narcissist.
That's life.
A narcissist doesn't have the ability to identify with that person's feelings.
They accused me of trying to bury my brother. But family violence has many ramifications.
They have no ability to reflect feelings.
You were the only member of your family to view your mother's body after she died.
Yes.
Why did you do that? I'm curious.
Because I loved her and I wanted to say goodbye to her.
This may be weird. Did you love your mother?
No, I didn't.
They have no ability to identify with what that person might be experiencing at the time. And be empathetic. Now, this is different from sympathetic. I'm talking about empathetic, where they can identify with that person's feelings, put themselves in their position for a minute, and understand how they might be feeling.
When I was 8, 9 years old, my job was to entertain the gentleman, take him into the bar, fix him whatever drink he would like, and I fixed the stiffest drinks in the world. And I kind of enjoyed seeing what happened very quickly afterwards.
They don't have that ability, which is why it's very difficult for them to ever have a close relationship with anybody. So we're talking about a sense of self-importance and entitlement, preoccupation with fantasies. They create this world of how special and how important they are. They believe that they're special. They believe that they're unique. They're very exploitive. They're very arrogant. So you'll see them doing something that you would think, oh my gosh, they must be embarrassed about this. They don't read the room. They just want to know that they're the focus of attention, and they assume everybody thinks they're as special and unique as they think they are. Again, they're very envious of anybody else that thinks they're special.
I have a picture in the book of me trying to dress up like Joan Crawford. And she would put the eyebrows on me. Well, I cannot tell you what I looked like at 10 years old with that. I mean, Groucho Marx is Klein. And I even wore the ankle strap shoes, nearly killed myself trying to walk in them. And I have a belt on that says Joan. And there I am, standing there, posing for one of the fans.
Now, there are people that, you know, kind of think they're special, and they may kind of be show-offs or whatever. A lot of people are that way sometimes. When I'm talking about a narcissistic personality disorder, I'm talking about a consistent pattern of behavior that you'll see over and over again. Not occasionally, not they just have a day where they just kind of think they're all hot stuff. I'm talking about a pattern of behavior across time.
When did the conflicts between you and your mother become fairly serious? About the time that you went to boarding school?
Well, I think that was one of the reasons for my going to boarding school, that and that she had to travel a great deal and just couldn't be home, you know.
What would, at the age of 10 or 11, what would you get into hassles about?
Naughtiness, you know, just everyday naughtiness.
And so with your mother's approval, you went to Carnegie Tech?
Yes, for my first year in college.
Now, what was that like?
Well, that was marvelous, absolutely marvelous. And here I was among my own kind, doing exactly what I had wanted to. It was a wonderful year.
And yet you quit Carnegie Tech in spite of the fact that it was this paradise, because why? Why didn't you keep going back and get your degree?
Well, because I got very impatient, which is, I suppose, the malady of the young. And I wanted to come to New York, because I understood that New York was the center of theater in this country, and that's where I wanted to be.
What was your mother's decision when you decided to leave college and come to New York?
Well, she wasn't very happy about it, because she did want me to finish college, as I suppose all parents do. But she said, well, if that's what you want to do, and if this is what you have your heart set on, then please go ahead.
And didn't she get you a job here in New York?
Later. After I'd been here about a year, she did at MCA.
Mm-hmm. And then what?
I left that too. But
you left MCA?
Yes, I did. Because I didn't want to be behind a desk. I wanted to be up on the stage.
Well, how did you feel when one of her daughters wrote that book? Did you call her up and say,
it
why?
It took 5 years off my life and all her friends' life. Anybody who knew her, it just killed us. It just ruined us. It was all, she took a little molehill and made it into a mountain. Now, one time Christina took me to the closet, and this is a true story. She took me in her bedroom when I was visiting, and she said, look, Aunt Dorothy, look what I have to wear. So she slid open the closet all the way across, a sliding door closet, and there were the most beautiful dresses that I would have loved to have had, like Cinderella. But she was pretty well developed, and she was about 15 then. And I think maybe she meant, I thought, what is she doing, bragging? But I think what she meant was she didn't want to look like a little girl anymore. She was going through a transition. Many children do that. But that was wrong. That was no big deal. Look what I have to wear. I think that Christina, she was on the plain side, you know, she's not a very pretty girl. She's kind of bulky looking face like, but I think that she was in high school and grammar school and everybody said, your mother is Joan Crawford, oh, you lucky thing, you know, and she figured, oh, yeah, show off her mother sometime.
Christina, I have a letter here from your sister, which you know nothing about. This is written to me. I just want to read one passage of this letter. She wrote me this in September when she heard you were going to be on the show. This paragraph says, I've heard that you will be interviewing my sister Christina Crawford in October. It's later than that now, of course. I want you to know that my sister Cindy's and my feelings are in complete contrast to those of Christina's. We are ashamed and heartsick that she could come out with such malicious carp about our mother. Please know that there are many of us, especially Cindy and me, who respected, admired, and above all, loved our mother dearly. Sincerely yours, Kathy Crawford Lalonde.
These people tend to gaslight you if you try to call them on their behavior. In fact, I always tell people that ask me about it, they say, look, I've put up with all this that I'm going to put up with. So, Doc, I'm just going to call them out. I'm just going to confront them and get in their face and let them know you're not special. You're not unique. You're taking advantage of me, and I'm not putting up with it anymore. They're going to play the victim role and attack you, and before it's over, they're going to be in a victim role and telling you that you're the one with the problem, and trust me, they have more staying power than you do. They will never give it up.